Hello and welcome to Worship with Christ United Methodist Church. I'm Pastor Jenny.
And I'm Pastor Kirkland. We want to thank you for joining us for worship. We are glad that you were here today.
We hope that you'll let us know that you're worshiping with us by filling out our worship check-in form, which you can find on our website, cumethodist.com. On our website, you'll also find additional information about the church as well as our ministries and programs.
We want to let you know about some ways you can take a next step with us following this worship service. On Tuesday evenings on Zoom, Pastor Amanda is leading a discussion group focused on decluttering and discerning what to keep and what to let go of.
And on Thursday evenings, we are leading a book discussion group on Zoom on the book Wholehearted Faith by Rachel Held Evans and Jeff Chu. We're also starting up a new Connect group that we're calling Theology on Brew. This is a monthly meetup opportunity that will alternate between coffee shops and brew pubs here in Rochester. Our first meetup will be Thursday, February 10th at 6:30 at Little Thistle Brewing.
We're also offering a new members class on Sunday, February 13th at 10 a.m. between our two worship services. If you are interested in becoming a member of Christ UMC, or merely want to know more about what church membership is all about, we invite you to attend.
In addition, our next new members class, on that same day, Sunday, February 13th, we will also resume in-person worship with our 9 a.m. tradition service in the sanctuary and our 11 a.m. Arise service in the ECC. We'll continue to live stream both services, so beginning Sunday, February 13th, you can attend either in person or online. It's exciting to anticipate returning to in-person worship, and we want to thank you for helping our congregation to keep each other and our surrounding community safe during these past few weeks.
With this worship service, we're continuing a series called Augers, Nets, and Rods, Fishing Stories for Every Season.
And in this service, we're going to explore a little bit more about it, what it means to become fishers for people.
So thank you again for joining us for worship today. Let's now enter this time of worship with this call to worship.
Gentle and patient.
God, you are calling.
Careful and persistent.
God, you are calling.
In grieving and in praise.
God, you are calling.
Through dawn and midday.
God, you are calling.
Unexpected and planned.
God, you are calling.
In a still, small voice and in power.
God, you are calling.
Spontaneous and prepared.
God, you are calling.
Willing or protected.
God, you are calling.
Our God is eager to share with us wherever we are in our journey.
May we be diligent to listen.
God, you are calling. Welcome to worship.
Thank you. played with magnet tiles before? I love how they come in different shapes, colors, and sizes. Each one is unique, just like each of you are unique. It reminds me of a Bible verse, Psalm 139, verse 14. I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works. My soul knows it well. What does this mean? It means you are beautiful. You are wonderfully made. You are created by God. You are known by God. You were created to be you. Each of these magnet tiles are beautiful on its own, but when I put them together, I can build something really special. When the children's bell choir plays, each person has a part, and when those parts are put together, they make a beautiful song. A soccer team has many players playing different positions, but it is when the team members work together that they make a goal. Can you think of any other ways we work together? Even Jesus had his disciples to help him share the good news about God's amazing love. And remember, you are wonderfully made, loved by God. And when you work with others, you can share God's love in amazing ways. Let's end in prayer. Dear God, I am wonderfully made. Be with me as I share your love. Amen.
Would you join with me in prayer? Holy God, you have called us by name, and we are yours. You call us to look for the lost, the lonely, those with heavy burdens. You have called us to share the good news of your great love for each and every person, regardless of age, race, or ability. And you call us to use the gifts you have given us to help others. We seek to be healers, peacemakers, comforters to those who grieve, workers for justice, those who live with integrity. Forgive us when we fall short, when we turn our backs on those in need. Forgive us when we are selfish or mean-spirited. Thank you, loving God, that you promise us restoration when we seek forgiveness. Thank you for laboring alongside of us to bring your reign on earth as it is in heaven. Gracious God, we pray for Mary Peterson and those in need of your healing touch. We lift up the family of Jean Dunn in this time of sorrow and pray for all who mourn. We ask that the people of Tonga receive the help they need in their time of trouble. We pray for wisdom for world leaders as they deal with the crisis in the Ukraine. All these prayers and the silent petition of our hearts, we pray in the name of our Lord Jesus the Christ, the true light of everyone. Amen.
As we move into our time of offering, we want to invite you to share your gifts with the ministries that come through and with Christ United Methodist Church. We are honored to be part of the way that God is moving here in the Rochester community, and you are invited to share your gifts through the mail or online by going to our website. Thank you for your generosity in the ways that you continue to support the work and the ministry and the service of CUMC.
Thank you.
A reading from Psalm 139. O Lord, you have searched me and known me. You know when I sit down and when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from far away. You search out my path and my lying down and are acquainted with all my ways. Even before a word is on my tongue, O Lord, you know it completely. You hem me in, behind and before, and lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is so high that I cannot attain it. Where can I go from your spirit? Or where can I flee from your presence? If I ascend to heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in Sheol, you are there. If I take the wings of the morning and settle at the farthest limits of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me, and your right hand shall hold me fast. For it was you who formed my inward parts. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. May we now join our voices and pray together in the unity we find through God's Spirit. God, you know us better than we know ourselves. You know our thoughts, our weaknesses, our motivations, our sins, and you love us still. Forgive us when we don't believe such love is true or possible, when we wonder how you could love us just as we are, when we forget our intricate construction, fearfully, wonderfully made in your image. Remove from our minds every thought which keeps us from you. Break down the walls. Push aside the pride. And help us to trust anew. You know our hearts. You love us and call us your own. Amen.
A reading from Mark chapter 1, verses 16 to 20. As Jesus passed along the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and his brother Andrew casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And Jesus said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fish for people." And immediately they left their nets and followed him. As he went a little farther, he saw James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John, who were in their boat mending the nets. Immediately Jesus called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired men and followed him. Will you pray with me, please? O God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight. O God, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. We have called this sermon series, as Kirkland referenced earlier, Augers, Nets, and Rods, Fishing Stories for All Seasons. And last Sunday afternoon, we put that title to the test as a group of about 19 of us headed out to Willow Creek Reservoir for ice fishing. I'm so grateful to Pastor Amanda for organizing this outing because it was the first ice fishing experience for many of us who came out. And I'm happy to report that it was also a successful fishing outing. So congrats to Brett Osby for catching the fish that we will now all share credit for because we were there. It was a great chance, really, though, just to see what ice fishing is all about. And I think we definitely perfected the part of any kind of fishing that involves chatting and standing around waiting for the fish to bite. We're really good at that. This standing around, however, also involves stamping feet and running in circles to keep warm. But perhaps most importantly, we all made it back from ice fishing without frostbite or falling through the ice, mostly. I found it really intriguing, but also a little kind of unsettling to be standing out in the middle of a pond, especially when Oliver used the auger to drill the holes, and we could actually see the snow and ice all the way through to water, moving water. I even started thinking that maybe we should shift our scripture for this Sunday to the story of Jesus walking on water, because that image suddenly had a lot more to do with fishing than I had ever realized. But given how well-known and maybe misunderstood the concept of fishing for people is in our faith, it seemed important to explore that a little more. Now, you may remember from last week that in Luke's version of the call of the disciples, that Jesus is already on the scene, teaching and healing, when he guides Peter to deeper water to find that miraculous catch of fish, and then tells Peter not to be afraid because he's going to become a fisher of people, which seems to lead directly to Peter, James, and John doing just that, leaving their boat behind and becoming disciples. Mark's version of these events is a lot more simplified and compacted than Luke's, as is really the style of Mark's whole gospel. For starters, the call of the disciples takes place in chapter 1 of Mark, so it's right at the very beginning of the story of Jesus' life and ministry. And in this version, rather than borrowing a boat to go out onto the water, Jesus is just walking along beside the sea when he sees Peter and his brother Andrew out fishing. Jesus invites them to follow him and become fishers for people, which apparently they do. And then a similar exchange happens with James and John, who, it is noted, leave their father and other fishermen behind in the boat as they go to follow Jesus. But that's pretty much it. No miraculous catch of fish, no Peter falling down and proclaiming his sinfulness, no mention of fear or extended conversation about what it really means to be fishers of people. Mark's gospel is also full of urgency, little phrases like immediately and at once that move the story along and that we see reflected here too. Jesus calls and they go. But what exactly is Jesus inviting them to do? Now, being a disciple or follower of a teacher was a well-known concept, but Jesus didn't use the word disciple here. That's not what he called them to be, at least in this portion of the gospel. So maybe the phrase fishing for people somehow made more sense to Peter, Andrew, James, and John than it does to me. Because I think it seems a little odd to invite fishermen to be part of some kind of fishing activity and then promptly have them leave all their fishing gear behind. It would be as if we had invited everyone to come ice fishing with us on Sunday and then asked everyone to keep their warm clothes, their poles, their bait, and the auger in the car. Now, on some level, this is clearly just a metaphor, and it's meant to tie in with what these men are doing for a living when Jesus encounters them. As Reverend Scott Hosey of Calvin Seminary writes, maybe had they been construction workers, Jesus would have invited them to become builders of human hearts. Maybe had they been real estate agents, he would have invited them to become sellers of kingdom turf. But I think there's more than just that metaphor going on here. And given how much harm has been inflicted in Jesus' name by people who claim to be fishers of people, it seems important for us to grapple a little bit with this language of being fishers of people and what the disciples were actually being invited to do, what anyone who is a disciple of Jesus is being invited to do. See, part of what's confusing and even problematic is the language, because this fishing imagery brings to mind hooking people, catching folks, luring them in by any means necessary. Anyone that we fail to reel in, of course, is the one that got away. So it's up to us, the mighty fishers of people, who are called to bring in the catch for the Lord. Now, that is a terribly patronizing and self-centered form of discipleship at best. At worst, it's actually destructive because it causes people to feel like they're a prize to be won. A fish dangling on the end of a line or crammed into a net with other poor souls who need rescuing from the waters of sin, also known as their life. And evangelism and discipleship is a tricky topic to talk about any day of the week, mostly because of those kinds of associations. For a period of time, my dad worked in development for the Foundation for Evangelism in the United Methodist Church. And during that time, my brother couldn't even bring himself to say the name. He called it the E word, evangelism. I get it. This fishing metaphor has its limits too. But I do think that there's something of resonance there for all of us as we try to figure out what it means to be a faithful follower of Jesus and how we share our faith journey with others in an authentic way that doesn't make us sound or act like Captain Ahab. I think it would probably help if we could first of all just drop the entire image of fishing for people having anything to do with a single person standing alone casting a rod. Because these fisher people in Jesus' time, they use nets, not rods. That's what they were working with when Jesus called them. Nets. And they certainly weren't doing it alone. Nets, and especially full nets, typically take many hands to use. Fishing was shared work. It was a group effort, not a solo expedition. And while there's nothing wrong with time by yourself out on the water, we just need to be clear that the invitation to be a disciple inherently involves being connected with other disciples. Fishing itself was also a very different endeavor in first century Galilee than it is in our lives today. Even in a state like Minnesota, where we love our fishing, this image of being called to become fishers for people, it doesn't sound quite the same to us as it would to those first disciples, because most of us don't have livelihoods that center entirely around fish. Fish is something, and fishing is something that we think of doing for fun, for relaxation. But for Peter, Andrew, James, and John, it was a job, one that was not glamorous or even particularly well respected, and very hard work. They smelled like fish. They looked like they spent all day in the water. They probably sounded like fishermen. So Jesus calling fishermen to be disciples should perhaps be an indicator that being a disciple isn't as much about having a particular set of skills and training as it is having the heart and the fortitude to show up and to do the job, to give ourselves to that hard work of following Jesus, which is also meaningful and worthy, even life-changing if we let it. Dr. Ted Smith, a professor of homiletics, argues that verse 17 from this passage should actually be translated not as "follow me and I will make you fish," but "follow me and I will make you to become fishers." And there's a world of difference in being invited to become something than to do something. We all have plenty to do. But whether we are professional fisher people or not, following Jesus to become fishers for people is about reorienting our lives around the way of Jesus as we interact with those people, letting Christ's love live in us, infuse how we work and love and give and argue and forgive. Kind of like how the smell of fish starts to make everything else around it smell like fish. We are meant to let the love of God infuse everything around us. Because we are not only the people called to be disciples of Jesus, we are also the very people that Jesus came to reach and to love and to save. We are the people that God knows inside and out, like Psalm 139 reminds us. We are part of this beautiful, beloved, and redeemed creation, not apart from it. So maybe being a fisher for people isn't about winning people over or convincing them of anything, but just letting them get close enough to realize that we too are fish and also becoming fishers. Not by dangling bait in the water, but putting ourselves out there into the world in authentic and vulnerable relationship. Also letting ourselves be loved and transformed and renewed by the love of God in Jesus Christ. Caught up in the net of grace. There's an artist named Janet Eckelman who has become famous for her artwork involving nets. Not just little nets, big city block-sized nets. She first discovered this medium while on a Fulbright scholarship in India. In preparation for a series of painting exhibitions around the country, she had her art supplies shipped to the small fishing village that was serving as her home base. But the supplies never arrived. In her daily walks on the beach, Eckelman had seen fishermen bundling their nets on the sand. and it occurred to her that the nets themselves could be utilized as a new form of artwork and sculpture. And so she collaborated with those fishermen to create her very first fishing net sculptures, hoisted up onto poles and shifting and transforming in the wind. And eventually her work began to grow and evolve into large public displays in cities around the world that look a little bit like this. Beautiful, colorful, rippling nets surrounding and hovering over people as they walk and eat lunch and go to work, probably looking up from time to time to wonder, to marvel at the beauty that's there, maybe even to call out for help in a fishing net. That's what people can discover in a fishing net. That's the kind of life that I imagine Jesus is calling us to as fishers of people, the kind that catches us up in wonder and awe, that surrounds and enfolds us in everyday life, in the love of God, but also gives people the freedom to swim away, to figure out how to live into that love, and to trust that it is indeed an invitation to grow in the fullness of life with God. Not a bait and switch. To know that we are not a prize to be caught, but living expressions of grace. For you created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. You know, we cannot wait to welcome you back to in-person worship here in just a few weeks. But I want us to remember that we don't ever need a church building to do the work of being a disciple. A welcoming statement here at CUMC includes the declaration that we welcome people of all races, nationalities, theologies, abilities, sexual orientations, and gender identities. And it's important to be explicit about that, especially in a denomination, in a world where people don't always know that they can be truly welcomed as they are. But just as importantly, I think, our statement also ends with these words. We offer a safe and compassionate place to reconcile faith, identity, hope, understanding, and mutual respect. That is not just an affirmation. It is an invitation to life with God, with other ordinary people doing exactly the same thing and who might smell a little bit like fish. If you are still wondering what it means to be a disciple, I suspect it is something just like that. Amen.
Sharing, dreaming, daring, as you
Go into the world and let the love of God in Jesus Christ live and move and invite others to this journey with you. Go in peace.